Ladies and gentlemen, you've had a very busy day and a long day, and we move into the 11th scientific session, and I would be very grateful if the speakers for this session, Dr. Soyibo, Dr. Bailey, and Dr. Morrison is already up here, if they would join me on the podium. I believe the first presentation is going to be given by Dr. Adedamola Soyibo, who is a senior lecturer with the University of the West Indies at the Mona campus, a consultant in internal medicine and nephrology at the Department of Medicine. His major interest is epidemiological work, looking particularly at the chronic non-communicable diseases and the role they play in renal disease and renal disease itself, and the disparity between ethnic groups in the chronic non-communicable diseases. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Soyibo.
Good afternoon, everyone, and I'd just like to thank the presenters for inviting me again to talk about diabetic nephropathy. I know this is sort of the last session, so I'm going to try and, I'm going to try and go through this as quickly as possible within the time frame given. I'm going to spend about 3 minutes on epidemiology of diabetes in Jamaica. So I think Dr. Tamu Davies already spoke something about the Jamaican Health and Lifestyle Survey, but I just want to focus on diabetes aspect of it. So we have a prevalence of 8%. And what's interesting is the number of persons who actually are on treatment is just 71%. And if you were to use a HbA1c of less than 7, then less than 50% of those population is actually controlled. And as we all know, prevalence of diabetes increases as your BMI increases, which is exemplified by work by Wilkes et al. So getting closer to home, assessing the risk of chronic kidney disease in Jamaica community of Northwest St. Anne, so a study that was done about 2 years ago, and basically just looking at risk factors. So we found diabetes, hypertension, and obesity along with overweight being the risk factor of 357 population, predominantly female, almost 70%. And the prevalence of diabetes in that population was 11.3% with a male to female ratio of 1 to 2.5, which means there were more female than male. Hypertension was almost 50%, which is higher than what is reported in Jamaican Health and Lifestyle Survey 2. I know there's a third one, but not privy to the information as yet. And when you look at the cases of self-reported hypertension, those persons who report that they have hypertension was 33%, but those persons who were actually found to have systolic blood pressure greater than 140 and diastolic greater than 90 was actually the prevalence increases more. And for combined overweight and obesity, it was 61.5%. Now, getting closer to the University Hospital where I work, so we conducted a study in the clinic. Just a little thing about diabetes clinic at the University Hospital, we only see those persons with diabetes and are complicated, so they are complicated cases. And the aim was just to look at the CKD among those patients that are attending the clinic and to determine the risk. So we use the definition of CKD. We're just going to take the opportunity to, you know, sort of talk about CKD a little bit. And so we have several equations that we can use. So in the old time, we can use the 24-hour urine collection to calculate creatinine clearance. And as time went on, we decided not to use that because, as you can imagine, it's cumbersome and it takes forever to get the result. And then they have other means of calculating GFR, so which we call the estimated glomerular filtration rate. We have the Cockcroft-Gault equation, which came on stream initially, and then we move on to the MDRD, and then now we're at CKD-EPI equation, which is what was used in this particular study to define CKD and to calculate the GFR. And if most of this equation uses a combination of any one of, well, it always takes into consideration your ethnicity or race, your gender, serum creatinine, and age. Some also use serum BUN, and some also use your serum albumin. And we define CKD in that population as those persons who have GFR less than 60, or if they have albuminuria that is greater than 30. Now, the problem with this is the regular albumin stick that you use in your doctor's office only picks up macroalbuminuria, so it has to be albumin greater than 300. So for you to pick up those with microalbumin, you have to get the special stick to, or you can just send them for urine microscopy urine analysis, or you can do a spot albumin to creatinine ratio to determine whether they have micro or macroalbuminuria. So just looking at the characteristics of those persons, this was the average age, 57 for women, 57 for men and 54 for women. And systolic blood pressure, average systolic blood pressure in men and women. And if you look at the HbA1c, if the average in men seemed to be better than the average in women, and the obesity was clearly more in women, which sort of reflects, you know, what is in the national registry. Even things like cholesterol level, it seems to be higher in women. So looking at the prevalence, so what we found was for total prevalence was about 22% of the population had CKD by definition of using less than 60 for their GFR. And looking at albuminuria, we also found that, you know, close to 60% in men and women had a definition of CKD using albuminuria. And when you combine both, you come up with an overall prevalence of CKD in diabetic population at 86.3. And this is closely relates to what the international literature publishes that speaks about 3 out of 4 diabetic patients are going to have diabetic kidney disease. So if we were to look at the plot using the grid developed by Kedoki in 2012, basically what we're saying is for our patient with diabetes and kidney disease, the only set of group of persons who have the least risk factor for cardiovascular disease are those in the green zone. And that amounts to about 13%. So you can imagine that in the diabetic population that we have, everybody else is going to be at least minimum moderate to increase risk of cardiovascular disease. And of course, so which means therefore, when you diagnose somebody with diabetes, you need to look for concomitant cardiovascular risk factors, including proteinuria. So let's talk about the metabolic and the hemodynamic physiology in diabetic nephropathy. So nephropathy, it's a very complex thing that occurs. Thank you very much, ma'am. Now, that has taken 5 seconds of the presentation, but appreciated. So nephropathy occurs as a result of interaction between metabolic and hemodynamic factors. So metabolic, the hyperglycemia, and then hemodynamic, these are changes in blood flow within the kidney affecting both afferent and efferent arterioles. And of course, all of this now is going to result in inflammation within the glomerulus and all the apparatus. So the tubules are going to be affected, the incision is going to be affected, and the vascular supply to the kidney is going to be affected. So in diabetic nephropathy, it's not just hyperglycemia that is at play. What I want to highlight is inflammatory mechanisms. So the whole inflammatory cascade is also affected, which is going to lead me to a subset of treatment option that nobody seems to use, but we'll discuss it anyway towards the end of the presentation. So what about oxidative stress? We all know about the role of nitric oxide and oxidative changes in vascular beds, in the myocardium, in the glomerulus, in the kidney, brain, that affects a lot of biochemical alteration, and the kidney is no different. And that has been also been implicated in the pathogenesis of type 2 diabetes and all of its complications. Insulin resistance in skeletal muscle. I just put this there because sometimes we talk about people, the lipids level and the fat distribution, adipose distribution, but sometimes intramyocellular lipid also correlates better in some study with insulin resistance than using the BMI or waist to hip ratio or total body fat. So we might want to be on the lookout for, you know, studies that look at this, or maybe we might want to design the, those for ourselves. What about inflammatory cytokines? You know about interleukins, you know about tumor necrosis factor, interferon, colony-stimulating factor, and transforming growth factors. These are all also responsible, whether through humoral mediators or just being cytokine-associated signal pathway, these are all responsible in diabetic nephropathy. And this slide basically integrates both the metabolic and the hemodynamic factors that affect diabetic nephropathy. So let's just try and bring things down a little bit much more digestible, because I know all of that was just probably a little bit too much. So what does that mean? It means, simply means, that when you see a patient with diabetes, the first thing you need to do is, or if they have diabetic kidney disease or they have CKD, the first thing you need to do, you need to define the cause of the kidney disease. So sometimes they have albumin in the urine, they have peripheral neuropathy, they have sensory, peripheral sensory neuropathy, or sometimes they have retinopathy, and you can make a diagnosis of diabetic kidney disease easily, but not everybody has that. Actually, there was a study that was performed, and they found that almost 76% of persons with type 2 diabetes had other glomerular disease associated with diabetes. Now, when we think about other glomerular disease, we are hopefully looking for diseases that we can treat so we can reverse the effect of whatever is happening. So the first you need to do is define the cause of that chronic kidney disease, and in this case, it would be diabetic nephropathy, and I will show you how to make a diagnosis of diabetic nephropathy. Then we need to calculate the GFR. At every visit, we need to know what their GFR is. And then we need to know whether they have albumin. So whether they have less than 300 but greater than 30, or they're greater than 300, which roughly equates to micro or macro albuminuria. Then we can now look at their risk factors, because at the end of the day, we're talking about cardiovascular risk. So green is low risk, moderate risk, high risk, and very high risk. And this will help you to choose drugs that you're going to use, drugs that goes beyond just glucose lowering, but have effect on also on cardiovascular, other cardiovascular risk factors, whether it be lipids, whether it be hyperuricemia, whether it be weight-associated risk factors. So, you know, patients always ask me, they come to the office, I prefer to see them early. We don't want to see them at GFR of 30 or 20, and then they ask me, so doc, when am I going to go on dialysis? And just to have an idea, you know, what is your decline, rate of decline for if you have diabetic? So for those with overt nephropathy, those are the ones that are going to be positive dipstick in your office. So the rate of decline is for type 2 diabetes anywhere between 5 to 7 mils per year. So you can calculate, that gives you an idea. This is somebody who obviously blood pressure is controlled, all the other risk factors is controlled, HbA1c is controlled, and also they have to avoid the use of nephrotoxic drugs. The natural history, so when you look at these people, most of the time, stage 1 or stage 2 diabetic nephropathy, they usually have hyperfiltration. Urine creatinine is dead normal, so please don't rely on the serum creatinine and bone to make a diagnosis, because by the time you make a diagnosis, based on elevated urea and creatinine, guess what? You will have lost 50 to 60% of your kidney function. And then by that time, it's already kind of late to trying to slow down things. So how do we evaluate? Where do we have different types of classification of diabetes, and you all know what happens. Then we look for someone comorbid conditions that are associated with diabetes, and this is a recommendation from the American Diabetes Association. We need to look for some of these things as they come with diabetes. What about screening? So that hasn't changed, 5 years for type 1 diabetes, that diagnosis for type 2 diabetes. What do you need to do? You need to do a spot albumin to creatinine ratio. Try and do early morning sample, please. So which means the patient goes, picks up the bottle or the container from the day before, and they pass the first early sample of urine in the container and they take it to the lab. Or better yet, carry the urine in the bladder, and then when they get to the lab, they can void. You need to repeat that 2 times, at least 3 months apart, so you can make a diagnosis. And then you need to also estimate their GFR. So depending on what stage, GFR might be normal or supernormal. Now, it is going to be present if you have those, but be careful of certain things. So like if they have hematuria, that doesn't, you're a bit cautious, that doesn't represent diabetic nephropathy, it is said, but there are some cases that you can find hematuria with diabetic nephropathy. But there are certain key things you should look out for. No evidence of retinopathy. Again, they might not be likely. Maybe there's something else, but if you're in doubt, please refer so they can have further evaluation done. And this just gives you sort of like a breakdown of what you need to do, screening for diabetic nephropathy, all the way to what you do based on the patient. You also always have to factor hypertension in the whole investigation. So what they found in an autopsy series that patients during their lifetime present with clinical manifestation of diabetic nephropathy. Some of them did not. We're talking about 267 autopsy series that were done. And when they look at the notes, only 20% of those persons actually were diagnosed with diabetic nephropathy. Whereas when you look at the autopsy series, they had biopsy-proven evidence of diabetic nephropathy. So effective modalities. So there are two primary techniques available for health providers to sort of assess, because we all want to know, how are we doing? Patient, what do they want to know their number? So you can use self-monitoring blood glucose at home. So fasting glucose, 2-hour postprandial reading, random, not all 4 of them every day. I usually tell them they just pick 2 or 3 and just, you know, mix and match. Or you can look at the HbA1c. Sometimes you can do continuous glucose monitoring or interstitial glucose, which I've never personally used, but this is our recommendation. And what's the target? So ADA still says, you know, less than 7, but then they say consider less than 6.5 in those persons who have no problem of developing hypos, or they're not at risk for developing hypos. And then for those persons who are not so, or who are at risk of developing hypo, they have reduced life expectancy, then you need to consider maybe less tight, stringent. You know, you don't have to get to 7 HbA1c or even 6.5. I like this slide because it allows you to sort of think about the patient in front of you while you're picking your HbA1c. So if they have risk of hypoglycemic or drug adverse effect, if they have disease duration that is more than 10 years or less than 10 years, life expectancy, relevant comorbid conditions that could predispose them to hypoglycemia, if they have established vascular complication, what are you trying to achieve? And they look at their support system, and that will give you an idea of how close away from 7 you need to be with your HbA1c. And this talks about the different therapy that you can mix and match, but I'm going to show you what Kedogi recommend in terms of patients with diabetic kidney disease and reduced GFR. Cardiovascular disease, you need to consider that highly, because it's not just about reducing HbA1c, we also want to reduce their cardiovascular risk factors. And diabetes itself is an independent risk factor. And if they have proteinuria, that's also an independent risk factor for cardiovascular disease. So these graphs just simply just shows a very nice linear relationship between albuminuria and cardiovascular risk. So as your albumin increases, even below microalbumin level, you can see that the hazard ratio for cardiovascular disease also increases. And as your GFR falls, then you have an increase in your cardiovascular disease. Just to say also, as your GFR falls, the control or the number of drugs that is required for diabetes also gets less. So the patient feels happy that they were diabetic, taking a large number of drugs, so about 5-10 years ago, and now they're probably on a small dose and they think that diabetes is disappearing. No, the kidney function is actually getting worse. So what about hypertension? So you will always see hypertension with diabetes. So that's one thing you're gonna find as time goes on, as you develop diabetic kidney disease, you're gonna have hypertension. So you need to think about those persons with hypertension added, which is also a major risk for atherosclerosis, cardiovascular disease, both in type 1, type 2. So you need to, you know, address that issue. Treatment of hypertension, remember to use ARB. If they have proteinuria, you need to consider using some kind of RAS blockade for them. And those are the medication that is advised. If they're on ACE or ARB, please remember to monitor their serum creatinine, because you don't want to, you know, make things worse, because you'll expect some kind of increase, up to 30% increase in serum creatinine when you initiate ACE or ARB. But more importantly, you need to monitor for potassium levels. So you initiate ACE or ARB, you need to monitor their potassium. And sometimes they have type 4 renal tubular acidosis with diabetes, and that will predispose them also to hyperkalemia. So you have to be careful. And then if they happen to have heart failure, and the recommendation says use aldosterone antagonists, then they're also going to be predisposed to hyperkalemia. So what about lipids? So at diagnosis, you need to screen them for those things. How am I doing with time? I don't see Shelley. Optimized glucose control obviously will help to reduce the diabetic kidney disease. So once we make the diagnosis, everything else that we do is sort of slow the progression to end-stage renal disease. Stretch them as far as you can. Protein restriction is something that we also do. We recommend 0.8 grams per kilogram of body weight. This changes if they become dialysis dependent, whether they're doing hemo or they're doing peritoneal dialysis. So the prescription that is written to the nutritionist also changes based on that. Try and reduce their urine albumin secretion. So for those who have microalbuminuria, we need to try and find a way to use ACE or ARB, or sometimes I've had to use renin inhibitors because they actually reduce proteinuria. Consider using a low dose, and I always tell the patient, you're not hypertensive, I'm using this drug because of the protein in the urine, so they can explain it to subsequent caregivers or physicians that they meet in the future. Similar. So ADA says if their GFR is less than 30, refer for evaluation for renal replacement therapy. We don't want that, okay? Refer early so we can have a dialogue with the patient, and then we can look at all the factors that can slow down progression. Now, if you're an internist or you are perfectly okay managing diabetes with kidney disease, then that's fine. The other thing you need to consider is drugs. You need to adjust their drugs, right? So drug medication, whatever you're gonna give them, needs to be adjusted. And yearly measurement of creatinine, all patients, at the beginning, so you should at some point. Once the GFR starts to fall below 45 to 60, which is stage 3A, then you need to start to look for other things that can affect their quality of life: bicarbonate, hemoglobin, calcium level, phosphorus, PTH level. All of those things need to be monitored. And once you start to see deviation from the norm, you need to implement treatment. What about those with GFR between 30 to 44? Those are stage 3B. Again, similar things It's needed, but more than likely you're going to find the development of these diseases or these abnormalities, and they need to be addressed for sure at that stage. And once less than 30, refer to nephrology. So what does the KDOGI say in terms of drugs that you can use? Treatment of diabetes and diabetic kidney disease, stage 3 and above. So those are stage 3, stage 4, and stage 5. Insulin, you can use insulin. The only thing I will advise with insulin use, so patients who are on TDS insulin, remember the kidney is responsible for excretion of insulin. So if you use TDS insulin, you might have to consider cutting it down to BD or maybe even once a day, because now the insulin will last longer and definitely have to consider reducing the dose. What about SUs? First generation SU, we need to avoid. Glyburide, we need to avoid. Only second and maybe third generation sulfonylureas are recommended. Bigonides, well, metformin is an old guy that has been around, and every time the GFR restriction keeps getting less and less and less. And the most recent advice is that if you have somebody on metformin, even when their GFR falls below 30, once they have no symptoms or no sign metabolically of metabolic acidosis, then you can still consider continuing the metformin. Obviously, the problem is they can now complicate their GI symptoms that they do develop as their GFR falls. What about the TZDs? Well, sure, you can use TZDs in stage 3 and above. All DPP-4 inhibitors are welcome. Some need dose adjustment. Oral diabetes, so I mentioned the preferred sulfonylurea, DPP-4 and SGLT2. So the use of perindopril reduces nephropathy and microalbuminuria, probably even reduces the development or time development of end-stage renal disease, as one study shows. So what about RAS and CKD? So CKD, or whether it's diabetic CKD or hypertensive CKD or ischemic CKD, or even due to lupus, you need to think about those hemodynamic effects and the non-hemodynamic effect that we spoke about, the whole vasoconstriction of the afferent arterioles, and of course the remodeling, which is an adaptive response, just like in the kidney, or just like in the heart. You know, you have that remodeling that leads to left ventricular hypertrophy and then leads to dilated cardiomyopathy. The same thing happens within the kidney. So you need something that's going to block angiotensin II to prevent those progressive disease. So these are some of the recent overview that we speak about when you talk about angiotensin receptor blockade and the effect, and you're going to end up dampening majority of this effect that normally happens with diabetic with kidney disease. So what about ARBs? Well, good old losartan in the trial that was done does show some benefit. Irbesartan also shows benefit, either 150 or 300 milligrams compared to amlodipine in a particular study. What about SGLT2? We have a lot of them around the place. So we have DAPA, we have CANA, we have empagliflozin, which are all available. I'm sure you're going to hear talks about this, about the wonderful drug and their effect on cardiovascular event sometime tomorrow in presentation with the cardiologist. But suffice to say that this class of drug is very useful in that, one, you're going to reduce albuminuria, which is one to do, right? You're going to reduce hyperuricemia, which is great. You're going to lower lipids, okay? You're going to reduce oxidative stress, weight, visceral adiposity. You're going to reduce your sympathetic nervous system activity. So all of these things are additional benefit that goes beyond just glucose control. Now, what about therapeutic implication of inflammatory cytokines? We cannot ignore them. They are part and parcel of the whole pathophysiology. Okay, so these are also drugs that can be used. So we talk about mycophenolate mofetil anti-CD20 antagonist, which has been used in experimental model infliximab, which also, and then the good old pentoxifilin that people always ask about. Remember, you're going to have to use it TDS to get the full benefit. So to summarize, we need to slow the disease progression. That's what we need to do. We need to make the diagnosis, we need to slow the progression, we need to use drugs that are going to be effective, that are going to go beyond just glycemic control. And obviously, it's not just the work of the physician, the nutritionist is involved, the entire community is going to be involved. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Soyibo, for that talk on diabetic nephropathy, which included the epidemiology, pathophysiology, and some clinical management issues. I think we have time for just one question or comment. The floor is open.
Thank you, Chairman.
Dr. Raju.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Sir, that was excellent presentations. Congratulations. My question, despite the management that you have told us we are giving, still the patient is having albuminuria. He's 50 years old, type 2, and the role of allopurinol, aldosterone antagonist in the absence of heart failure, is helpful to reduce the albuminuria. Can you make a comment on that, please? The role of allopurinol in reducing albuminuria in diabetic nephropathy and aldosterone antagonist.
That's a very good question. And so we do have a number of studies that speaks of allopurinol in terms of those persons who are on allopurinol and the reduction or the progression of their CKD, independent of whether they have proteinuria or not. So that is something that is being advocated and is being recommended nowadays. But the downside to that is there are some studies that were also negative, and there were actually some adverse effect of using allopurinol. So if you're going to use allopurinol, the main indication is if they have hyperuricemia. So for just proteinuria alone, I wouldn't use allopurinol just for proteinuria alone. But if they have hyperuricemia, I will consider it. Now that you've asked that question, on the issue of pentoxifilin also, if the patient has been on RAS blockade, then you could use pentoxifilin as an adjunct. But I wouldn't neglect RAS blockade and then use pentoxifilin in an attempt to reduce proteinuria. But if they have indication for it, then that's a different story. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Soyibo.
If the patient is unable to take the ARB or the ACE, what's the next antihypertensive which will be useful in that context? Because there are some patients who have a problem with those.
Okay, so any one of the antihypertensive can be used, even hydralazine. So there's a study back in the 1970s that looked at the effect of hydralazine along with, I believe it was hydrochlorothiazide or Lasix, or one of the diuretic, and it shows, you know, reduction in progression of their renal disease. But remember, hypertension management is also important. So whatever drug you're going to use to reduce their blood pressure, for those who have hypertension in diabetic kidney disease, so that's going to be important also.
Yeah, thank you very much. And I think when old people like me at the podium, we should mention that before we had ACE and ARBs, calcium channel blockers were being considered as protein reducing agents.
Sorry,
I think,
sir.
I must.
Old age starts at 95, sir.
Sir, yeah. I didn't quite get what Dr. Raju said. Yes, well, I'm actually 96.
Sir, we beg to disagree with that.
Could we move to the next presentation, Urological Complications in Diabetes Mellitus, by Dr. Belinda Morrison, who is a senior lecturer in the Department of Surgery at the University of the West Indies, Mona, and consultant urologist at the University Hospital of the West Indies, director of the Urology Residency Training Program, and whose main interest is research into cancers related to the urological system, especially prostate. Dr. Belinda Morrison.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for inviting me to be here. It is a pleasure and an honor, and certainly it's good to have a surgeon in the midst of everyone. So today I wanted to share on some of the common urological complications that we see in diabetes mellitus, and just to say that the urologist's role is much more than getting involved in transplant or complex urinary tract infections, or even just a male with erectile dysfunction. And I'm gonna focus mainly today on diabetic bladder dysfunction, asymptomatic bacteria, and urinary tract infections. I know the speaker following me will be speaking a little bit about erectile dysfunction and hypogonadism. So I'm gonna utilize two cases, and perhaps we have patients that are similar to these patients, and it probably will engage a discussion at the end. So our first case is that of a 75-year-old female with type 2 diabetes, as well as hypertension, high cholesterol, and severe osteoarthritis. She's on several medications. She's obese, she doesn't exercise, and she has a chronic history of storage lower urinary tract symptoms. And by that I mean increased urinary frequency, urgency, nocturia. And she thinks this is really related to her uncontrolled diabetes mellitus, so she's adjusted to it. However, she noticed sudden worsening of her lower urinary tract symptoms with an episode of urinary incontinence, which she was very hard to qualify, but appeared to have been urge urinary incontinence that occurred in a public place, resulting in soiling of her clothes. So it was quite embarrassing, and she presented for evaluation. On examination, we noticed that she was obese. There was no abdominal mass or tenderness, no pelvic mass. She did not demonstrate stress incontinence on exam, and there was no cystocele or prolapse noted. A urine culture was done, which grew E. coli, which was sensitive to most common oral antibiotics, and she was commenced on this, and she got a one-week course of antibiotics. However, despite the one-week course of antibiotics and clearing the E. coli UTI, she continued to have these storage lower urinary tract symptoms. We did a KUB ultrasound just to exclude any structural lesion like a bladder mass or pelvic mass or bladder stone, and this was normal. So our assessment at the time was that of a previous history of a treated urinary tract infection and a baseline history of diabetic bladder dysfunction. And for the physicians in the room, perhaps we do have some patients like this. Our second patient is a little different. This is a 61-year-old female with type 2 diabetes who admits the poor control of her diabetes, very poorly compliant with her medications. I saw her because she was admitted to hospital with a febrile urinary tract infection. On evaluation, we found that she was in chronic urinary retention. She had no pain at the time. However, on physical exam, she had a distended, palpable, non-tender bladder. She was catheterized immediately, and 1.2 liters of cloudy, malodorous urine was drained. On admission at the time, she was noted to have very poor glucose control. She had obvious signs of sepsis. She was febrile. Her white cell count was elevated. Despite this, had a normal renal function. So she was commenced on empiric antibiotics, resuscitated, and her catheter was maintained. She had a KUB ultrasound and luckily showed no hydronephrosis, but debris was seen in the bladder, which just suggested the chronicity of her condition. She was discharged home with a catheter and taught to perform clean intermittent catheterization. However, she was not very good at doing this. It was very, very difficult. And for many of you who know women with chronic retention, it's really hard to teach women how to self-catheterize. Probably much easier for men than for women for obvious anatomical reasons. And so she was able to get the services of a nurse who could do CIC, and she promised me that this would be done regularly. If you think about how many times a normal human being voids per day, she was asked to have CIC done at least every 4 to 6 hours. But when I reviewed her, this was only being done twice weekly, and this was really for financial reasons. The nurse charged her a fee each time she came, so clearly she couldn't have it done 4 times per day. Luckily, she was voiding, but not completely emptying. So in at least 2 subsequent ultrasounds, assessing her residual volume, we were seeing very high residual volumes, debris within the bladder, getting recurrent bouts of urinary tract infection. Luckily, none enough to admit her to hospital another time, but certainly this was disturbing. And there was obviously the concern for now recurrent pyelonephritis or renal impairment. She refused to be recatheterized despite this infrequent CIC, and so she continues. She obviously also has diabetic bladder dysfunction. So this concept of diabetic bladder dysfunction many years ago was called diabetic cystopathy, but it was really exclusively used in a situation where this dysfunction occurred with someone who had a neurogenic bladder, or it was due to a neuropathy, what was perceived to be a peripheral neuropathy. And now we recognize that diabetic bladder dysfunction is far more than this. It's not just excluded the person with a neuropathy, but the pathogenesis is certainly multifactorial. It can present in various ways, and we just presented two patients with the diverse presentations. The patient that has overactive bladder symptoms, which we often say this may just be due to age or high glycemic levels, or the person with poor flow, or the person with urinary retention. So it's a spectrum. The prevalence is thought to be anywhere between 25 and 87%. However, bear in mind many of these studies that have looked at, cross-sectional studies that have looked at the prevalence, have confounders in terms of age. So we do know that as patients get older, they may also get overactive bladder symptoms. And so it may not necessarily be primarily due to their diabetes. Neurological disorders, previous CVAs, can also present with overactive bladder symptoms, and certainly good old BPH in men. So we do see a lot of older men who have BPH, who have diabetes, and we're not really sure what is the predominant cause of their lower urinary tract symptoms, but it's a common entity. And so this just describes how there is a transition from the early phase where they have overactive bladder symptoms. And if we were to do urodynamics, which is a pressure flow study of the bladder, we will see that they have the overactive bladder picture. So during filling, in the resting phase of the bladder, there are these unstable contractions. And it's during these unstable contractions that they get the urge to void and that they have to go on void. And it manifests with increased frequency. And so they get a hypercontractile bladder. But in the late phase, it changes now to not storage symptoms, but now voiding symptoms. They're not able to empty, or they empty a little, but they're not emptying very well. And on urodynamics, what you see is an acontractile bladder, an atonic bladder. So on a pressure flow study, when they're asked to void, you see very low pressures, and they may not void at all. And so we must recognize it. It's said that about 55% of patients with diabetes will have these overactive bladder symptoms in the early phase. And if we look for it, we will find it. And they present, as I said, with frequency, nocturia, urgency. It's thought that this may be due to hyperglycemia leading to a polyuria, and there are changes in the bladder as a result of the polyuria. So the detrusor muscle gets thicker and bigger, it contracts more, and so they have more frequent contractions. But it's a late stage that we're very fearful of. And this is typically the triad of decreased sensation. So they don't sense when they're filling. The normal bladder should be able to sense filling initially at about 150 mils. And at about 300-400 mils, you should have maximum sensation of filling. Well, in these persons, they don't sense filling at all, or at very, very high volume. So their bladder capacity increases and there is poor emptying. And on urodynamics, this is manifested at in very late sensation of first filling, decreased contractility, and an increased residual volume. Luckily, this complication is seen much less in diabetes, maybe in just about 23% of patients, and it is thought to be mediated by oxidative stress. So the combined pathogenesis of this diabetic bladder dysfunction may be due to changes in their muscle, maybe increased muscarinic receptors leading to this overactive bladder presentation, maybe changes increased calcium going into the muscle, leading to increased contractility. There is, of course, a role of the peripheral neuropathy and also changes in the urothelium. The issue is that 25 to 50% of patients with this will not complain. They think it's normal, they have adjusted, because it's very subtle. The changes are quite subtle. So unless we ask, we won't find out that they have these symptoms. And so as we treat patients with diabetes, we must ensure that we ask them about any lower urinary tract symptoms. So we have to evaluate for either storage lower urinary tract symptoms or voiding LUTs. we must get a sense of their glucose control and if they have complications. And it's been found that patients who have complications of their diabetes are probably more likely also to have the diabetic bladder. Other signs of autonomic dysfunction is their past medical or surgical history that could account for this and not necessarily their diabetes, what drugs they're taking, and also their dietary history. An examination, important things we want to look for are distended bladder. In our second case, she had no complaints really of poor emptying, but on examination, she was in chronic urinary retention. So we have to examine these patients, examine men for BPH to see if this may be the offending cause, or any signs really on clinical exam of a neuropathy such as saddle anesthesia and absent bulbocavernosus reflex. And in the woman, to exclude any pelvic masses such as a large fibroid uterus, large ovarian masses, or even prolapse. The basic investigations that we would need for these patients are urinalysis and culture, to exclude an infection, of course, since we know a urinary tract infection can present with storage lots, getting a sense of their glucose control or if there's any renal impairment with an HbA1c and urine creatinine, and also a baseline ultrasound, not to make the diagnosis, but certainly to exclude other anatomical causes. And urodynamic testing is baseline. It really should be done, although not done in most patients. The system metrogram just tells us about filling pressures, and the pressure flow studies tells us about voiding pressures, and we can also assess their post-void residual. So how do we manage these patients? And this is where patient education is very, very important, to tell them what is happening and what they can do on their own. So weight reduction is very, very important in these patients. A lot of them are overweight, and it has been proven that weight reduction can improve overactive bladder symptoms, not just in diabetics, but in patients as a whole. Dietary modification, anything in the diet that may be an irritant to the bladder. So bladder irritants or things that will promote diuresis. So caffeinated beverages, we usually suggest that they restrict. Anything with citric acid, whether juices or fruits, spicy food, tomato-based products, alcohol. We tell them to assess their timing and the volume of fluid intake. We do not suggest that they reduce their fluid intake, because what will happen instead is that they get very concentrated urine, which is also a bladder irritant. So we encourage them to drink liberally. However, if they find that they go very often at nights, that perhaps they would like to restrict their nighttime intake to an hour to two before bedtime. Pelvic floor physiotherapy is put here deliberately, not just to tell them to do Kegels exercises, because most people are told to do Kegels exercise and they don't know what they're doing, and they're not doing it right. Really, you should not be contracting your abdominal muscles at the same time as the pelvic muscles. And so we now have physiotherapists that can teach us how to do pelvic floor muscle exercises. Sometimes it requires not just teaching the exercises, but also electrical stimulation. When you recruit those muscles and there's the urge, and you can contract those muscles, it helps to dissipate the urge. And so they can hold their urine much, much, and much, much longer periods of time. Timed voiding, trying to hold the urine for at least 2 to 4 hours if possible. And this is a stepwise approach. So we don't ask someone who's going every half an hour to get jumped to 2 or 3 hours right away. We say give yourself maybe 15-minute intervals. And if for a week they're able to hold it for an extension of 15 minutes, then they extend it for another 15 minutes the next time around. Managing constipation is also important, because it actually worsens their symptoms, and you would know as well, glucose control. So a lot is behavior modification, especially in the first stage. In the second stage, really, there's not much to do, because you cannot regenerate bladder function or contractility once it becomes atonic. But our role really is to make sure that the bladder is empty, and as empty most times as possible, because we want to reduce the risk of urinary tract infection. We're going to reduce the risk of high storage pressures, which could perhaps impair renal function in someone who is already prone to renal impairment. So the only way to do it is through clean intermittent catheterization. We do not advocate long-term catheterization. So patients should not be having catheters change every 4 to 6 weeks. It's just not on. There are many, many complications. So we teach patients how to do clean intermittent catheterization. But if that is difficult, especially in the case of women, caregivers may be taught. And this is where the challenge, the real challenge exists. So when you see some of our patients who still have catheters, it's usually because they aren't able to do it themselves, or caregivers refuse to do it, and it's a real thing. You know, patient two lives with her son, and we certainly didn't want her son to be taught how to catheterize his mother for, you know, obvious reasons. And she wasn't comfortable with that. And so she had to rely on a paid source on a limited income. So this is the only way, really, we can modify bladder emptying, you know, and this is through clean catheterization. And remember, it's clean, it's not sterile. They can use non-sterile gloves. You know, the hallmark of teaching CIC started with people with spinal cord injury from wars many, many years ago, and it really reduced the risk of urinary tract infection. And if they're taught well, they can do it well. What about medications? For phase one, there are medications. And in Jamaica right now, we're limited to just detrusitol. Oxybutynin, which is an old drug, is probably very, very hard to get anymore. And so we are limited to tolteridine. There are many other anti-muscarinic agents, such as solifenacin, darafenacin, either immediate release or extended release, which we do not have locally. We still also have imipramine, which is not only very good in being an anti-muscarinic agent, but also has it relaxes the bladder neck as well. So it's very beneficial. Contracts the bladder neck as well. So it's very beneficial for these patients. However, we'll talk about side effects in a little while. For the atonic bladder, people always ask, is there no drug you can give to stimulate the parasympathetic nervous system, get that bladder to contract? And really, the answer is no, and there's no good study that suggests that this will work. And hence, there's no drug therapy for the late stage in patients with an atonic bladder. Adverse effects of the anti-muscarinic agents, we have to tell patients about dry mouth, blurred vision, dizziness, somnolence, and constipation. And yes, sometimes our patients do not respond very well to the anticholinergic. So what do? Well, we may combine agents, but if we combine agents, we can augment side effects. So in the whole world of treating the overactive bladder, once pharmacotherapy fails, another option, which is a real option now, is Botox injections. But it's probably something we would not use in a diabetic patient because there is a strong risk of urinary retention and requiring a need for catheterization in these patients. So a lot of times when we try the anticholinergics and they may not work and combined agents don't work, we have to combine with pelvic physiotherapy as well as dietary modification to see how this will assist them. So asymptomatic bacteria, I mentioned here just because it is so common, and I do see a lot of patients with it, and I thought it was important to mention. As the name suggests, it's asymptomatic. The patient has no symptoms. However, there are over 10 to the 5 colony-forming units of bacteria per mil in the urine. So on first glance of a urine culture, that's probably just done routinely, we may say, oh, this person has an infection, I need to treat. But the first thing to do is to take a proper history from the patient. Are they having any symptoms suggestive of a UTI? So are they having burning, frequency? Now, this is where it gets a little muddled because these are patients who probably already have overactive bladder symptoms. So they may have frequency, but do they have really strong symptoms of a UTI? Malodorous urine, cloudy urine, maybe a hematuria. And if they have these, and the urine culture is positive, then it's not ASB, but it's a UTI and it should be treated. But if this is just something that is incidentally found and they have absolutely no urinary tract symptoms, then it is ASB. And is ASB treated in diabetics? No, it's not. It's very, very common. It's said that ASB is found in about 2-5% of healthy adult women. Even in the sickle cell population, ASB is much more common. ASB is more common in elderly persons, persons who are institutionalized, and 30% of diabetic women will have ASB. The only population group where ASB should be treated are in pregnant women because of the risk of preterm labor and intrauterine growth retardation. If we are going to go and do some endoscopic or open surgical procedure for fear of an infection because of the invasiveness of the procedure, or persons who are immunosuppressed like those with HIV/AIDS. But in the absence of that, we should not treat ASB. So if we do a routine executive profile and we may do a urine culture as well and we see a urinary tract infection, yet there are no symptoms, we can comfortably say we will not treat because it is ASB. And a lot of patients, if you track them over a period of time, you may find subsequent urine cultures are negative because it's not a stable phenomenon. So I mentioned it here because I thought that this is something that as physicians or practitioners treating patients with diabetes, we may see. And then, of course, urinary tract infections, varied, maybe simple cystitis, which is more a nuisance than anything else, pyelonephritis, which can become quite troublesome in the patient with diabetes, leading to urosepsis, and then more complicated emphysematous cystitis or emphysematous pyelonephritis. Now, these are with gas-forming organisms, and that can lead to sepsis in many of these patients. We usually have to admit them and treat them with antibiotics, or renal abscesses that may need to be drained via interventional radiology or surgically. So these are some of the infections that they get. Seen very commonly in type 2 diabetes, and it is said that it's seen more commonly in women than in men in general for UTIs, and the risk increases with the duration of their diabetes. In all patients, ideally, we should get a urine culture. So in our diabetics, it's probably not so wise just to give antibiotics without getting a culture, because we know how uniquely susceptible they are to UTIs. If we suspect they have a UTI, it's probably wise to give them the culture form and write the prescription and tell them to go and do the culture, then start the prescription. Because if they do not respond, then sometimes you're not really sure what's happening. And sometimes we may be treating what is not a UTI. Quinolones in our population are probably still first line. However, I'm sure many of you recognize now multi-drug resistant strains and resistance to a lot of quinolones. And now Bactrim seems to be the drug that is sensitive in a lot of cultures, so we can bear that in mind. Persons with diabetes that is complicated, we find that it's associated with longer hospitalization, bacteremia, azotemia, and septic shock. And so we recognize that when we see, in urology, we see patients with urinary tract infection, we are very, very aggressive with them in diabetes mellitus. So I just wanted to quickly mention for the next 5 minutes the results of a local study that we conducted partially at the Diabetes Association of Jamaica. It was a cross-sectional study that we did, and we really wanted to look at the prevalence and the predictors of erectile dysfunction in males with type 2 diabetes and see if there was an association with their HbA1c levels and why maybe we could use this as a screening test or a marker in our patients when we saw them. We also wanted to see if there was any association with lower urinary tract symptoms. So as I said, it was a cross-sectional study conducted 5 years ago between University Hospital Diabetic Clinic, KPH Diabetic Clinic, and the DAG. The patients were given an IIEF score to complete with a nurse practitioner, and also an overactive bladder screening questionnaire. We measured their weight, height, BMI, and we measured their serum HbA1c levels. We looked at the duration and complication of their diabetes, any treatment that they were getting. And really, I'm just going to present a summary of the findings. This was a short form for the overactive bladder questionnaire. Has 6 questions, and we're able to use this to get a sense of if they had an overactive bladder, as well as the quality of life questionnaire based on their overactive bladder symptoms. And what we found was probably quite alarming. Now, granted, we know that we were seeing patients at the diabetic clinic at the university, which we know probably will have maybe more severe patients with diabetes as well as KPH. But we also saw people at the diabetic clinic in Kingston, and approximately 82% of the patients had erectile dysfunction. Many of them had severe erectile dysfunction. 38% of them had severe erectile dysfunction, and the sample was 185 males. So we thought that that was interesting, also because many of these patients were not being treated and treatment was not discussed with them. So again, this is something that we need to think about, and I'm sure Dr. Bailey will go into detail. And when we looked at patients who had erectile dysfunction, the major predictors really for erectile dysfunction were age, so older age, higher blood pressure, both systolic and diastolic, the duration of their diabetes, and complications of their diabetes, as well as if they had dyslipidemia. We know the major risk factors for erectile dysfunction are hypertension, diabetes, hyperlipidemia, obesity. And so we bore out in this study conducted locally that these were some of the predictors as well. On multivariate logistic regression, the significant factors for erectile dysfunction that predicted for erectile dysfunction again were increasing age, but in addition, use of alcohol, a higher HbA1c level, and if they had complications of their diabetes mellitus. We found a lot of them also had overactive bladder symptoms. So if over 80% had erectile dysfunction, about the same had overactive bladder symptoms. Only 17% considered themselves normal. It means 83% had some form of erectile dysfunction, with severe being seen in 42% of these patients. So again, just to say, we should screen our patients for lower urinary tract symptoms. What we found was that better erectile function was associated with less urinary bladder symptoms. So generally, if patients had erectile dysfunction, they were more also likely to have overactive bladder symptoms. And we now know in urology that this may be due to a number of complex events, probably even related to nitric oxide levels, which are generally lower in patients with diabetes. It leads to lower nitric oxide levels associated with erectile dysfunction, but also we are now knowing it's associated with overactive bladder symptoms in these patients. We found that better erectile function was associated with higher urinary quality of life symptoms. So if a man with diabetes wanted to have better erectile functions, he was most likely also to have better urinary symptoms, which is what we found. We did not find an association between the HbA1c levels and erectile function, certainly not as we had thought from our study. And you know, there were previous studies that did not find an association either. So what we found in summary was that the prevalence of erectile dysfunction was quite high in our sampled local study, as well as the prevalence of overactive bladder symptoms in our diabetics. And it taught us that we really should be asking more when we saw these patients. So in summary, diabetes is associated with several urological complications. Patients should be asked about these symptoms as we see them on a regular basis. We should note that asymptomatic bacteria is common, but it should not be treated. UTIs are common and it should be appropriately treated. And erectile dysfunction is common in sample Jamaican men with diabetes mellitus. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Morrison, for that very informative talk on bladder dysfunction in patients with diabetes mellitus, the symptoms, investigations, treatment, management, and your collaborative study on erectile dysfunction in patients with diabetes mellitus. I think we could take just one question or comment. Yes.
Thanks, Dr. Morrison. Dr. Williams-Green from Linstead, I'm saying hi. Two quick questions. First of all, can a man do CIC? Can he do intermittent catheterization? And second question, if in the case of the erectile dysfunction, if you treat the problem, the cause of the overactive bladder, does the man's erectile dysfunction improve?
No. So thanks. Hi, Dr. Williams-Green. So can a man do CIC? Yes, he can. You know, anatomically, it's easy. He can lift off his penis, he sees the meatus, and he puts that catheter in. So which is why I said it's much easier for a man to do CIC. All he needs is a pair of hands, gloves, lubricant, stands up in the shower if he wants, lies down and has his kidney dish there, and he does it. In fact, we are trying to promote this in the spinal cord injury patients, the ones that are at Sir John Golden Rehab, or any spinal cord injury patient, to reduce the risk of recurrent UTI. So yes, men can do it, and we can teach men how to do it. There are many online resources for them to show them how to do it, and it's something that should be done. Usually, we like to use those silicone catheters, so the ones that are translucent, maybe about a 16 French, and it can be done. For the diabetics, ideally, you want to start every 4 to 6 hours, but then you get a sense of what their natural voiding pattern is like. So if they're able to void in between, maybe it's just in the morning and in the evening they need to do it. But yes, they can. It's much harder to teach a woman to do CIC. She has to sit down, she has to spread her legs, she has to have a big mirror in front of her, she has to use one hand to spread her labia, clean with the other hand, and put that catheter in. So it's hard. It's very hard for older women. It's very hard for women who have a big, you know, penis. So, which is why caregivers come in. Right? And a lot of times caregivers are not comfortable doing this. Sometimes caregivers may be practical nurses who say they are not covered to do this. And it's usually the very motivated practical nurse will say, okay, I will do it. And so we find compliance is an issue. And if compliance is an issue, you come back and you see they're having recurrent UTIs, we probably will just put a catheter back in. The second question is, if we improve their overactive bladder symptoms, if their erections will improve? Unfortunately, no. It's just a continuum. It's just something telling us that things are going bad, but you can't reverse it. So many of those changes within the blood vessels, within the nerves that are affecting their erections, it can't get any better. What we do tell them, however, is to make sure that they have good control of their diabetes and other comorbidities to prevent further decline. So a man will have, you know, ED and diabetes, and you start him on, say, sildenafil, you know, tadalafil, vardenafil. I'm not going to choose one agent here today, right? Right, Cora? And he responds. But he continues to eat the way he wants to eat. He doesn't exercise. His sugar is all uncontrolled, and then nothing. And the point is, lifestyle is very, very important. It's not just dependence on a drug therapy. And so we find that we can't reverse many of the damages that occurred before. Perhaps long term, you know, you can prevent progression.
Thank you very much, Dr. Morrison, and we don't like them to be retaining urine. We don't like them to have frequent urinary tract infection. They end up with a nephrologist, and they may end up on a certain machine, which we don't like to put them on. Let's move on to the other speaker, Dr. Alverston Bailey, who is a graduate of the University of the West Indies sometime in the last century. He's a member of the American College of Occupational and Environmental Medicine and a certified medical review officer. He hosts a program on television about people's relationship and sex, and he has quite an interest in sexual myths and sexual dysfunction in the elderly. And let us sit back and hear Dr. Alverston Bailey on sexual dysfunction in the elderly.
Thank you, Prof. I'm very pleased that you're able to stay for this special event. I can assure you that your wait was well worth it. Before I commence, I just want to lift your spirits a bit, and I need some help here with this toy.
Remembering so well the day that I met you, you took me in your arms and caused dreams to come true. From the fear of what would be, you came and rescued.
Now that I've awakened you. Now, my talk today is on diabetes and sexuality. Sex oftentimes is a perception. For those of you who look at this picture, I'm sure it's going through your mind. This poor lady said, I married him for his spark, but he seemed to be experiencing some ignition problems. On completion of this module, I expect you to have a comprehensive understanding of the impact of diabetes mellitus on male and female sexuality. We're going to cover a few areas. We're going to look at sexuality. We're going to look at human sexual response. We're going to summarize quickly female sexual dysfunction, male sexual dysfunction. We're going to look at then the impact of diabetes on these functions. Just want to remind you that sexuality is a little more complicated than you might think. Basically, it is made up of your physical, psychological, social, cultural, and spiritual well-being. Okay, sensuality basically then is knowledge of anatomy and physio, understanding of the sexual response, your body image, satisfaction of skin hunger, attraction and fantasy. We also want to introduce you to intimacy, which is caring, sharing, risk-taking, vulnerability and self-disclosure. Also want to remind you that sexual identity has to do with gender roles, orientation, self-esteem and confidence level, relationship with family and friends, your role as child and adult, and perception of yourself as either male or female. And then reproduction is contraception and fertility issues, lifestyle, STIs, a knowledge of anatomy and physio, and morality issues. And of course, sexualization has to do with your style of dress, your appearance and body language, advertising, movies, talk shows, harassment, sexual harassment, and a whole host of disorders called paraphilia. This gentleman and lady, Masters and Johnson, coined the term human sexual response many years ago. He described it as involving excitement, plateau, orgasm, and resolution. I want you to pay particular attention to this particular diagram, which shows that the sexual response of women is quite interesting. Some women actually have excitement, plateau, and have an orgasm, and comes to an end fairly quickly. Many women actually keeps going on and on and on indefinitely. And there's a reason for that, which we won't get into. The sad news, though, is that men oftentimes cannot achieve this objective. They rise and they fall precipitously. Very rarely do they actually are unable to keep going on. Now, there are different types of sexual dysfunction. Female sexual dysfunction, according to DSM-5, is characterized by sexual interest disorder, orgasm disorder, genitopelvic disorder, substance and medication-induced sexual dysfunction. And just to remind you, that lack of sexual desire disorder basically means lack of interest in sex. And I want to emphasize that carefully, because by the end of this session, I'm going to change your perception of sex, because I'm going to show you that sex is overrated. And I'm also going to show you with good evidence that most people do not like sex. So stand by. Now, sexual arousal disorder is failure to become adequately sexually aroused to engage in or sustain sexual intercourse. Orgasm disorder means difficulty reaching an orgasm, and sexual pain means that, pain. It can be lifelong or acquired, or it can be generalized or situational. This poor man has some serious issues. And this couple, as you can see, is heading in opposite direction. Male sexual dysfunction really is fairly similar. It is characterized by hypoactive sexual disorder, erectile disorder, premature early ejaculation, delayed ejaculation, and substance medication-induced sexual dysfunction. I want to show you something. This study was done by Pfizer in 29 countries, and it showed clearly that 47% of women were having some serious sexual problem. And this is 29 countries, and 42% of men had sexual problem. So women definitely are having some challenges. You won't be able to look at this, but when I saw it, it actually was quite compelling. What it showed, and is that in terms of interest in sex, that women in Southeast Asia and the Middle East have very little interest in sex. I worked that out. 42% of women in Southeast Asia and 42% of women in Middle East had very little interest in sex. But then I thought interesting, since we tend to believe that North Americans are overly sexualized, that is not true. The truth is that the sexual disorders in North America is actually quite high. Let's take a peek at this. Lawman in 1999 showed that 43% of women in America were having either low sexual desire, arousal problems, or pain. And men, 31%, were having premature ejaculation and other disorders. I thought this slide was quite compelling in that it showed clearly that women are having some serious issues. That low desire was very prevalent among women, ranging up to 33%. And in fact, I don't have this graph to show you, but a recent study has shown that American women are even having more problems now. About 40% of American women have no desire at all. They'd prefer if the men just leave them alone. And this is not because they're gay or they're having sexual identity issues. 38 to 40% of American women have no sexual desire, so you can understand the sexual harassment issue that is going on. Now, of interest, with respect to arousal problem, 20% had arousal problem. Rapid orgasm is the domain of men, of course, as you would suspect. And pain during sex, unfortunately, is a female issue. Now, I want you to take a look at this graph. It showed, you might not be able to see it clearly, but what it showed is that 2% of men were having pain, whereas orgasm disorder was 19%, male erectile disorder was 10, female pain was 10, female arousal was 20, female orgasm problem was 25, premature ejaculation 27, and the woman again, top the list, no desire, 25%. Now, with respect to the impact that this has on your state of mind, what it showed is that arousal problems was causing severe anxiety, pain in sex was also causing anxiety and depression. Orgasm problem was causing depression and anxiety. And you can see that sexual disorder, according to Dunn, was causing a lot of mental anguish. And the prevalence of sexual complaint in women is a kind of self-explanatory. Again, I want to emphasize, according to Lawman, that 32% of women in North America was lacking sexual interest. 28% was unable to achieve orgasm. 20% said sex was not pleasurable, and 21% was having pain. Of course, with respect to men, it's self-explanatory that men doesn't have an interest issue, but they have a problem with premature ejaculation and, of course, ED. You'll notice that the premature ejaculation is essentially the same across all age groups, but ED got worse as the men got older. Now, the etiology basically can be distal, which actually can be religious orthodoxy, psychosexual trauma, homosexual inclination, inadequate counseling, excessive alcohol, physiological problem, and sociocultural factors, all leading towards the immediate problem, which causes a thing called spectatoring. I find that term quite interesting, because spectatoring means that one person is enjoying sex, another one is watching and wondering what is going on. And that is very common. In fact, a female patient of mine told me that she can't understand what was happening. She had been married for 50 years, and she said, "Doc, why is my husband behaving this way? When we're having sex, why does his nose dilate? Why does his eyes roll over? Why does he appear as if he's going to die?" She said to me, "I was to eat him so." I said to her, "Because you make him feel good." She said, "But doctor, me now feel nothing." Very common problem. Now, female sexual disorder and diabetes can be caused by depression, hypoactive sexual desire disorders, dyspareunia, which is painful sex, and other issues. I just want to show you some evidence now to justify my arguments. Female sexual disorder have been described in diabetic women since early 1980s, and it has resulted in reduction or loss of sexual interest or desire, arousal or lubrication problems, dyspareunia, and loss of ability to reach orgasm. It has been found in both type 1 and type 2 diabetes, and what they found that the higher the frequency of female sexual disorder and the lower their female sexual score is oftentimes related to body weight. And several studies have been shown that women affected by obesity and metabolic syndrome tend to have FSD. What they've also found is that there's a strong correlation with depression, anxiety, and marital status. and depression was found to be a major predictor of sexual dysfunction. They also found that there's a relationship with age, duration of diabetes, the onset of menopause, microvascular complications, and psychological complaints. Another study by Esposito in 2010 found that not only metabolic syndrome, but atherogenic dyslipidemia also seemed to predispose to FSD. Now, I think you'd like to know that nitric oxide and PDE5 are being identified in human clitoral smooth muscle. That's supposed to be good news. Therefore, nitric oxide seems to play a key role in female sexual function. What I've also found is that diabetes may affect a lot of systems, but could be influenced, it could induce hyperglycemia infection, vascular and neurologic damage, and hormonal problems. So hyperglycemia, therefore, has been shown to reduce the hydration of the vaginal mucous membrane and causes pain. Moreover, hyperglycemia also increases the risk of genital urinary infections, which leads to dyspareunia. Diabetes also induces vascular and nerve dysfunction. And what they have found is that because of the vascular nerve dysfunction, there is impaired relaxation response. The vagina actually goes into spasm. There's decreased nerve-stimulated clitoral and vaginal blood flow. Therefore, the clitoris doesn't enlarge and the vagina doesn't lubricate. And there's fibrosis of the clitoris and vaginal tissues, which means the vaginal atrophy. And the muscular layer surrounding the vagina is reduced. Now, diabetic neuropathy also seems to play a particular role because it alters the normal transduction of sexual stimuli and inhibits the sexual response. They've also shown that hormonal disorders can impact on FSD and diabetes. And there's an alteration in androgens and estrogens. And for those of you who might not remember, androgens is what drives desire. And sex hormone binding globulins also is decreased. Moreover, there are a lot of endocrine disorders that impact on sex, like thyroid hormones, the hypothalamic pituitary dysfunction, and polycystic ovarian syndrome. And we mentioned depression already. How do you treat FSD in women? Well, you can modify life factors by recommending healthy eating. A Mediterranean lifestyle diet has been recommended, and you must screen and treat for depression. What they found is that women with the highest level of adherence to a Mediterranean diet lifestyle had the lowest prevalence of FSD. What they've also found, and there's a study called the Look-Ahead Study, which actually shown that women who actually went on a diet actually had a significant, a marginal improvement in FSD. Those who kept on eating what they normally ate had a significant drop in their female sexual function score. We also recommend that you modify risk factors because we know that lifestyle will improve insulin resistance, it will improve endothelial dysfunction, and it will avoid oxidative stress. Of course, we recommend you resolve psychological issues. And here's some advice. To treat hypoactive sexual desire, we recommend cognitive behavioral therapy, pharmacotherapy, hormone therapy, and you can also use some central acting agents. To treat sexual aversion disorder, which seemed to be a big issue in North America, you need to get involved in behavioral therapy, relaxation exercises, pharmacotherapy, SSRI, and give them some anxiolytic to relax them. Not to do what the comedian does. I mean, appropriate relaxation therapy. To treat female sexual arousal disorder, we recommend, and this some of you might find, might be uncomfortable with this, but we recommend that women be taught self-stimulation. They should also be taught sensate focus exercise. They should be encouraged to use sexual accessories. The truth is, for those who are not aware of what sexual accessories are, we call them in our language BOB, which are battery-operated boyfriends. We recommend, and they actually are extremely good and are far better than a man. far better. We recommend sexual education, and we recommend a special gadget which is prescribed actually, called an clitoral stimulator. We also recommend appropriate hormone therapy, which Dr. Whitburn described this afternoon. And of interest, you might be wondering about using nitric oxide promoters, and I'll talk about that shortly, and vaginal and moisturizers. This, for those of you who don't know, is Eros, absolutely fantastic little tool. It's a female vacuum therapy. You have to prescribe it. It works like a charm. You want another look? Here it is. Now, what about PDE5 inhibitors? Theoretically, they could improve vaginal lubrication, but the problem is that there's a very low PDE5 in the female reproductive system, and that it has not been shown to be very helpful in women. For dyspareunia, the lists of treatment options are many. You can actually use topical estrogen. For burning pain, you can use antidepressant. For pelvic floor pain, as doctor just mentioned, you can actually refer to physical therapy. And for anxiety, you need cognitive behavior therapy. For vaginismus, and this is a difficult one, this is where the vagina goes into spasm. And I actually was the best man at a wedding in which the marriage lasted exactly 2 days. The wife had vaginismus, and the husband had no idea what to do to overcome it, and tried to a forceful entry, and she walked out on him. And that's true. You need cognitive behavior therapy, pelvic floor physical therapy, and relaxation training. What about men? Men, well, have a number of issues: erectile dysfunction, retrograde ejaculation, altered spermatogenesis and hypogonadism, and benign prostatic hypertrophy. Now, hypogonadism or low testosterone may bring out symptoms such as decreased libido and energy. Ejaculatory dysfunction, the commonest one is retrograde ejaculation, which the semen ends up going up north rather than down south. And infertility and testicular atrophy has been attributed to diabetes, and benign prostatic hypertrophy might occur because of hypoxia-related cell proliferation. What about ED? Dr. Belinda asked me to dwell on this a bit, so I'll just quickly talk to you about it. The EPI study has shown that both type 1 and type 2 diabetes are associated with ED. The reported prevalence is approximately 50% of men in diabetes worldwide. Dr. Belinda's study showed about 70-80% in her cohort. In the Massachusetts male AIDS study, diabetic men showed a 3-fold probability of having ED when compared to men without diabetes. And as you can see in this study, as men get older, the ED got worse and worse. The occurrence of ED in diabetic is 10 to 15 years earlier in men with diabetes, and ED is more severe and less responsive to oral drugs in diabetics, leading to reduced quality of life. I want to pause and reduce quality of life, because a lot of women don't realize how men take ED seriously. I've had men come to me and indicated that he doesn't want a reduced quality of life. He doesn't want any life at all. In other words, men sometimes become suicidal when they have ED. Advanced age and longer duration of diabetes seem to predispose to ED. And we know diabetes is associated with other things, like hypertension, hyperlipidemia, overweight, and so on, which aggravates the condition. Now, there's a point I want to emphasize, that ED is said to be clinically equivalent to coronary artery disease. And that is a point that we really need to emphasize. And this particular paper actually showed that all patients with type 1 diabetes had ED prior to coronary artery disease. So ED is a precursor of CAD. Now, many drugs can actually cause ED in diabetics. We won't get into that. But I thought this was an interesting finding that was published by Nicolosian culture. We show that a moderate consumption of alcohol may exert a protective effect on ED in both the general population and in diabetic men. I thought it was an interesting little tidbit. Now, we know that ED is caused from vasculopathy, neuropathy, visceral adiposity, insulin resistance, and hypogonadism. And I thought this particular slide was very interesting because it showed that hypertension, dyslipidemia, and diabetes causes arterial stenosis, impaired vasodilation, and arterial insufficiency, which reduce penile blood flow. And of course, atherosclerosis causes smooth muscle atrophy and fibrosis, cause venous occlusive dysfunction, and cause excessive penile outflow. We know that diabetes, of course, causes macroangiopathy, microangiopathy, and endothelial dysfunction. And the important point I want to emphasize is that the same vascular endothelial injuries that occur in the coronary arteries are likely to occur in the cavernosal arteries, the primary arteries supplying penile erectile tissue, which is why erectile dysfunction equals endothelial dysfunction. Thank you. There's also another point I want to mention to you, that there is a progressive decline in serum testosterone level in American men. As you can see, as a man gets older, his testosterone gets less and less, which is why they end up with a thing called andropause, and they get really frantic. Now, just to touch quickly on hypogonadism, I find this particularly fascinating, and I want this to be a take-home point for many of you, that visceral adipose tissue causes increased aromatase activity, which converts testosterone to estrogen. Let me repeat. When you have a big belly, which is called visceral adipose tissue, your aromatase level increases, and you end up having, you become feminized, which is why a lot of men with large abdomen have a round face, they have breasts, and they have a high-pitched voice, because they're not the man that they used to be. Now, Balastella suggested that there might be a possible autoimmune pathogenesis of hypogonadism in type 2 diabetics, and he actually suggested that there might be the presence of anti-pituitary antibodies at high titers. I thought that was rather neat. How do you treat men with SD? Well, you can treat the erectile dysfunction with anticholinergics, antihistamines, and alpha-adrenergics. You can treat ED with lifestyle changes, PDE5 inhibitors, intracavernosal substances, and testosterone. Of course, we have to recommend tight glycemic control. We have to recommend that they conform to appropriate lifestyle changes, which increase physical activity, go on a proper diet, and reduce caloric intake. And I thought it's interesting. I want to show this to you because the pharmacologic therapy, there's some interesting information which I discovered, and I suspect Dr. Belinda knows it, that of the four drugs available in Jamaica, which is Viagra, Sildenafil, Levitra, Vardenafil, and Tadalafil, you need to remember that they have different durations, and Tadalafil has 36 hours duration. A study was done, in fact, to ask which PDFF does men prefer around the world, and I'm not trying to promote any drug here. That's just what literature says. You notice my slides have a lot of supporting evidence. And what they found is that in fact, men tend to choose Cialis than all the others, and there's a good reason, because it lasts much longer. And that makes a lot of sense. But of interest too, the question is, should men take PDE5 inhibitors on demand, or should they take it continuously? And a paper published in 2005 showed that daily Tadalafil led to a significantly higher IEF score and higher completion of successful attempts rather than on demand. It's something that we need to think of. Should ED now be regarded as a chronic non-communicable disease that might benefit from daily tadalafil? I want us to think about that. And of course, we have other options. We have intracavernosal injection, testosterone replacement, vacuum devices, and this, by the way, folks, works. I buy these regularly for my patients, for my diabetic patient. And there's a gentleman who I bought this for. He called me a week later and said, if you had $1 million, you'd give it to me because his life has been transformed. And that's true. Surgery is an option. I just want to summarize, therefore, that to screen all men with DM for ED, you need to screen for hypogonadism. You need to recommend PDE5 inhibitors if they're not having hypogonadism, or refer to a urologist. You might consider testosterone replacement, and if ED is present, you might go for EDE5. I want to thank you, just to remind you, that a satisfied life is better than a successful life, because our success is measured by others, but our satisfaction is measured by our own. Just to remind you, get a copy of my book, Sexplanation, A Guide to Discussing Sex and Sexuality in the Caribbean, available in all your favorite bookstores. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Bailey, the inimitable Dr. Bailey. And I'm quite sure that many of you would like to meet with Dr. Bailey afterwards for your questions and comments. I want to thank you all for this session. I think we're about an hour over time, and I think we need to make way for the next session, the 12th session of the day. Thank you all very much.